Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-616-8010. That's 1-800-616-8010. Again, 1-800-616-8010. Call now.
Attention business owners. We know that owning a business means getting things done right now. So if your right now list includes a new building, call the Right Now Company. General Steel. We can design a building for your business quickly and save you thousands of dollars. That's right, thousands. You may think General Steel only builds large projects or that you can't afford General Steel quality. Well, check these prices. How about a 40 by 60 foot building for under $22,000? Or even a 50 by 100 for under $35,000? That's right, a 5,000 square foot building for under $35,000. And these buildings all have General Steel quality. Best of all, you can still order a building and have it delivered in time to build this year. How's that for right now? So if your right now list includes a new building, call the Right Now Company, General Steel.
800-393-5756. 800-393-5756. 800-393-5756. That's 800-393-5756.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
Boy, man, I had a rough night's sleep. Boy, whew. I got a letter from the IRS yesterday, and I just couldn't sleep. Man, I'm dying here. Somebody help me.
IRS problems affect more than just your finances. If you're ready to take back control of your life and you owe more than $10,000, you need to call the Tax Doctor. Their expert staff can immediately protect you from the IRS and state collectors and get you the best possible tax settlement guaranteed. The IRS has recently released new programs geared in helping struggling taxpayers, where you may qualify to settle your tax debt and wipe out up to 85% or more of what you currently owe. If you owe $10,000 or more in back taxes, call the Tax Doctor right now. See if you qualify to pay less. 800-989-1694. 800-989-1694. 800-989-1694. Again, 800-989-1694.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. We leave no warrior behind. Wounded Warrior Project is a nonprofit organization created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war. Whether those scars are physical or mental, we're here to make sure that they heal. And whether it's helping those with post-traumatic stress disorder live a normal life again, or giving much-needed support to injured warriors and veterans hospitals. Because no one deserves our help more than the men and women who risk their lives to keep us safe. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind. Ever. Learn more about what we do at WoundedWarriorProject.org.
You want to know what time it is? It's time to bring the rain.
Zinc Media. Feel the power of knowledge.
Well, good Tuesday morning to you wonderful Liberty lovers and you wonderful ecclesiastites all across the globe. It is I, your lovable host, L. Rod, coming to you live from my bunkerized home studio somewhere within the great granite state of New Hampshire this snowy Tuesday morning. It is Tuesday, right? I don't know, I'm losing track of time. I'm just having way too much fun. So sometimes I think it's a day ahead and sometimes I think it's yesterday. When you lose track of time that way, it is said psychologically, well, psychology speaking or psychologically speaking, that when you that there are only two times when you lose track of time. And one of those, obviously, is when you are under heavy stress. The other time is when you when your brain is in a euphoric type of state. There's a third way of losing time, and that's lack of stimuli. I mean, you can't see the there's nothing to tell you that time is passing. So if you're locked in a dark room, you can lose track of time. In a euphoric state, when you're having all kinds of fun, ever notice that when you are having fun, time seems to fly by? I mean, you don't even know how long you've been doing whatever you've been doing. If you're doing something that doesn't require a stopwatch or a time clock, kids outside, oftentimes, you know, they're outside playing, just having a ball. Half the time, they don't even notice that the sun is, you know, setting. They lose all sense of time. Well, adults do the same thing. But also, when you are completely bored or you are under stress or doing something that you absolutely cannot stand or hate, you lose track of time. You actually think time is going slower than it is. And you have no idea what time. I mean, you've been somewhere for only an hour, but you think it might be two. Because you really don't want to be there. You just want to get it over with and get out and get on whatever you're doing. It just seems like you always say, Jesus, is he going so slow? Because that's your body loses track of reality, of real time. That's what happens. This morning we do have a special guest calling in. We have Congressman Ginta from the 1st Congressional District of New Hampshire. Congressman Ginta, is that you?
Yes, it is. Good morning, Rod. How are you?
Good morning to you, sir. Welcome to our snowy day. I see we've got an hour delay here in my neck of the woods in New Hampshire in Concord because of the snow last night. Are you in D.C. or are you back home?
No, I'm in New Hampshire right now, and my kids have a two-hour delay as well.
Ah, 2 hours, yes. Now, I know this is an awfully funny time for folks in Washington, D.C. right now, as well as across the country, with the announcement of the death of Justice Scalia. And we have people going back and forth about whether Obama should appoint someone. Your thoughts on this?
Well, look, Antonin Scalia, I think, was a giant on the court, my favorite Supreme Court justice, someone that I followed through his career. And I have to say, Rod, I'm a little disappointed that we, the collective political body, have turned so quickly into a discussion on whether he should be immediately reappointed. I would hope that we would take a little time just to honor and reflect on his life, his jurisprudence, and the direction in which he took the court and took a very important branch of government. So I hope that as we have this discussion as a country, you know, we properly remember, you know, his place in history. That being said, you know, because there is such a discussion about this subject matter, I'm very willing to give my opinion on it. And I would categorize it this way. I remember, I think it was back in 07 or so when Senator Schumer, who was adamantly against any Senate Democrat nominees by the president being considered or supported, 18 months away from President Bush's ending of his presidency. And so I find it a little ironic that, you know, Senator Schumer this week is all of a sudden advocating a policy that is 180 degrees different. And that's because there is a different person in charge of the United States Senate. Here's what I would suggest. The president, under the Constitution, has every right to put forward a nominee. He's currently the president of the United States, and he's got every right to do that. I think, as Senator Schumer suggested or inferred, you know, 18 months away from George Bush's completion of his presidency, that relative to President Obama, many people in this country are dissatisfied with President Obama's leadership, concerned with the direction he took the country. The fact that an election is underway, I think, really should probably give everyone pause. It doesn't mean that the Senate shouldn't hold hearings. I think they should. But, you know, if the president is going to put forth the nominee, let the Senate, you know, do its work, do its due diligence. And I think ultimately, you know, it would come up with the right response to this vacancy. You know, my personal thought is that the Senate will ultimately decide to wait until whoever the next president of the United States is. And I think that that, Rod, is probably the right decision to make. But I still think the process should go forward properly.
Well, I really agree with you on there. The president does have the constitutional ability and right to nominate, but it is it's Congress's job then to go ahead and vet that nominee, and that takes time. So I don't know if there is enough proper time to actually vet, especially now that there's Loretta Lynch's name is being bandied about as being that would be a hot potato.
Well, obviously. You know, I think, Rod, it depends on who the president nominates. I mean, typically, you know, the president would take his time in vetting, you know, the next Supreme Court justice nominee. I mean, it's an appointment for life. And, you know, if the president is not going to take this seriously and is going to chart a political course by naming someone, you know, inside of a few days or a couple of weeks, I think that gives you it tells you that the president's being more political than about policy and what's in the best interest of the country from a jurisprudence standpoint. And again, if it is someone like Loretta Lynch, I could tell you right now, I don't think that the United States Senate would confirm her. They have already vetted her to a certain extent. And while she was approved for Attorney General, I'm not sure they would consider her for a lifetime appointment. So I do think the process will move forward, and I think it's, you know, from a constitutional standpoint, and that's where I really look at this, the president should do his job and the Senate should do its job. You know, that being said, I do think you're right. There's probably not enough time to do this before the end of his term, which is why ultimately I think the next president will determine who the next Supreme Court justice is.
Well, with that said, that's a possibility of five justices being nominated and put on the bench by one president. That is unprecedented. That's a little scary too.
Sure, and that's why I think this election is even more important for, you know, typically, people don't consider, you know, the appointment of justices. But when you look at whoever the next president is, having the ability to appoint up to five, I think that does weigh heavily on the electorate in the general election.
Oh, I hope we get it right this time. Speaking of getting it right, you are a member of the House Budget Committee, and you were recently appointed to the Financial Services Committee. And the budget that the president is proposing is a monstrosity. I mean, we're talking, what's the total, over $4.2 trillion? Is that what I heard?
Yeah, it's over $4 trillion. So just a minor clarification. I've been on financial services, and I was recently appointed to budget. And I would point out, last year I voted against the budget and against the omnibus. Most people think Washington is so cynical that, you know, you get rewarded when you go along with leadership. Well, I actually went against leadership, both on the budget and the omnibus, and complained about the process so much that both the chairman of the budget committee, Tom Price, and now Speaker Ryan, approached me and asked me if I would consider going on budget and trying to utilize, my past experience on budget, my past experience as a mayor, to try to, fix what I perceive as the most fundamental problem, which is the process is broken in Washington. So I'm actually excited for the opportunity, Rod. I mean, it's a challenge. The president has proposed a more than $4 trillion budget, which never balances, increases our long-term debt to over $25 trillion, the most of any president in history of our nation, from the time he started his presidency until his last budget proposal. And it doesn't address some of the issues that he even talked about in his own State of the Union address, like regulatory reform, like emerging energy markets, tax reform that is necessary for economic growth. So I want to focus on, I think, three major areas. One, you've got to get to balance. You cannot fix the problems in this country without getting to a balanced budget. Secondly, we've got to start reforming mandatory spending. Social Security, Medicaid, Medicare, that is two-thirds of the budget. As you know, it's the driver of the debt. It's going to, that and interest on our debt are going to be the two largest sectors of our budget, which is just, from a balance sheet standpoint, just not feasible for long-term fiscal sustainability. And then I want to deal with regulatory reform, deal with tax reform so we get the economy moving again, and deal with health care. I mean, it's costing us more than $2 trillion. I think it's a failed approach, what this president and what the Democrats approved without any Republican support. So we've got to go in a different direction. We can start that now with the budget process, and I hope to make inroads over the next several months as we propose the budget and then go through the appropriations process.
Well, some of the most damaging or idiotic proposals within the president's budget proposal is this oil tax, another tax, $10 a barrel, which some economists say could raise the price of a gallon of gas as much as 25 cents per gallon. That's Now, we've just heard that OPEC and Russia have come to some sort of agreement to kind of limit the production. So we should expect oil prices to be on the rise on the world market again pretty soon if they actually cut production. So how is that going to help the economy if we're adding another 25 cents a gallon in tax on gas and diesel?
Well, I think the president's proposal is very typical of a liberal approach to governance. It's tax as much as you can and take those dollars and spend at the federal level. And, they think that is the wisest approach. I completely disagree. You're seeing OPEC essentially trying to, through a monopoly, increase the cost of oil, first. Secondly, the president's notion of $10 a barrel. I mean, he's doing it because prices are low at the moment, and he thinks he can get away with it. Well, it's going to dramatically increase the cost of gas. I mean, finally, there is some relief to, the average family where, you can get gas in New Hampshire, somewhere between $1.55 and $1.60 a gallon. I mean, and then, as you know, home heating oil is very critical, not just to our residential market, but to our commercial market. And it's been a barrier for economic growth in the state, high energy prices. So this would be, the worst time to create a new tax. And he's doing it simply for political purposes and to try to, squeak some more money out of the American economy. And that's just not going to propel the economy in the direction we want. We're already stagnating in terms of wages. And the president will always point to low unemployment rate, and I point to the fact that we have the lowest labor participation rate right now in the country in modern history. We have people who are no longer willing to look for a job because they feel like they can't get one. And wages have been stagnant since 2008. So, look, there's a lot of work to be done, a lot of issues for the presidential candidates to discuss. But what this president is proposing, I think, is out of step and out of touch with the average American person.
Congressman, I know you got to run. You're a busy, very busy man. But you recently, well, not recently, but you were a two-term mayor of the largest city in New Hampshire, the city of Manchester. And you did something that was unheard of for a long period of time there. You brought in a balanced budget. You cut taxes in the city of Manchester, which made you extremely popular, by the way, and still popular. People are still talking about you today. In fact, they want you to come back. I was talking to somebody over the weekend that says, well, maybe Ginta can come back and be mayor again. So you were a very popular person here in New Hampshire. Now, you're obviously, as with our other congressional leader here in the second congressional district, are up for re-election. What is going to be your main message to the people of New Hampshire to get across in your re-election bid?
Sure. Well, I think, you know, what I will talk about is the experience that I have in the private sector and the public sector. What I did as a mayor, balanced budgets, cut taxes for the first time, you know, over a decade. We actually cut borrowing, was rated one of the best managed cities in America. And really take that approach to Washington to try to fix what's going on. You know, look, I don't go along to get along. I think I do what I think is right for New Hampshire and right for the country. And, you know, that means breaking with the Republican leadership. And I've done that. And I think that that's the kind of voice that New Hampshire wants, you know, a thoughtful, pragmatic approach to solving our nation's problems. And then secondly, the things that I've worked on that are more closer to home, you know, the fishing industry is under attack by NOAA and federal regulations. I've stood up for them. I've stood up with the people of the community of Great Bay against the EPA and their mandates on nitrogen levels. I was able to get rid of the Cadillac tax, you know, help every municipality, every private business from a 40% tax. There are real substantive things that I've been able to accomplish, despite the fact that I don't always go along to get along with my own party. And I think that's what people are looking for, real leadership that is critical for New Hampshire and our country. So I'll continue to tell people that's the way I'm going to represent them. I also think it's important, Rod, to listen to what your constituents want. And, you know, I've got an ability, I think, through our We the People initiative, where people can call me directly, email me directly, and I utilize those ideas that come from people in New Hampshire to try to best reflect them through legislative initiatives in Washington. So I'll continue to do that, and that's you know, what essentially my campaign will be about.
All right. Well, in about, I think it's 2 years from now, or maybe 4 years. Any given any thought to running against Senator Jeanne Shaheen for that seat?
No, I really haven't. You know, I look at my work now that I is incredibly important, and you know, I've decided that I want to run for re-election, and I'm not looking beyond that. You know, people have asked me from time to time to run for different offices. I appreciate that very much. It's nice to be considered for other offices, but I don't really sort of plot my course. I mean, I go where I think I could best serve, and right now it's in the House of Representatives.
All right. Well, I for one am glad that you were there, and you didn't allow yourself to get booted out earlier in your term this term, but that you stuck it out. You actually did something that nobody expected. You turned it around, and you've been appointed to some important committees and doing good work, and I do thank you for that, sir.
Well, my pleasure, and thank you for having me on, and look forward to being back, Rod.
Thank you. Congressman Frank Ginta, 1st Congressional District of New Hampshire. Have a good day, sir.
You too.
Well, you know, we've got... There are people all around that can do good work for you and I, both in Washington and in your state capital. And we just have to be able to find those people. And look, in a nation of, what are we at, 320, 318 million people? There are a lot of people who are capable, fully capable, of doing the jobs that we need done in government. and doing them properly, doing them right, doing them constitutionally, both the federal at the federal constitution level and your state constitution level. That's just as important, folks. Just remember that. Because a lot of this stuff that is happening at the federal level that is coming coming against states, it might also not only be against the federal constitution, it might also be against your state constitution. And if you do not have a governor and a state legislature that is strong enough to stand up against the federal level to protect your people of your state and your constitution, then you need to replace them. You do need to replace them. Because this is about law. You know, we're supposed to be a nation of laws, not a nation of men, not a nation of kings, not a nation of emperors, not a nation of rulers. We are a nation of laws. That sets us apart from just about every other nation that has ever existed on this planet. Because we are supposed to be strictly about laws regardless of who is in leadership roles. The law is the law, and the law of the land is the federal constitution and your state's constitution. That's the law. And what we have now is a bunch of people in Washington, not like Congressman Genta, but unlike Congressman Genta, that are trying to break, usurp, and do everything they can to get around those two main laws. And you've got to take these people to task in your state, too, because it's... It's very important. I know we have... here in New Hampshire, they go to the Supreme Court. New Hampshire Supreme Court a lot over constitution. Law. And this is where it is important that you have the right people in leadership to nominate right now.
Because bankruptcies and foreclosures. To turbo boost your credit scores, call 888-541-5571 or visit us at 700creditnow.com. You've heard the old adage. Cash is king, but in some cases, credit can be just as powerful as cash. Not many people have $200,000 to put down on a house, or $50,000 to put down on a car, or $25,000 to put down in a business. But look around and you'll find that millions of Americans do have homes and cars all purchased with little to no money down. To turbo boost your credit scores, call 888-541-5571. Again, that's 888-541-5571. Or visit us at www.700creditnow.com.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-616-8010. That's 1-800-616-8010. Again, 1-800-616-8010. Call now.
Did you ever look at the stains in your coffee cup and then... realize that's exactly what happens to your teeth? Power Swabs is the 5-minute solution. Solution to get your teeth white without visiting the dentist. This is Ben Gordon with Power Swabs. And if your teeth are stained from coffee, tea, or smoking, all it takes is 5 minutes with Power Swabs. In 5 minutes, you'll see
Viagra at the lowest prices. Never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
When you're ready to take the edge off a hectic day, I suggest you start with a little music from Franz Black.
I guess there's lots of ways to look at things that don't seem right.
No Worries has just been released on iTunes and Amazon.
It's gonna be alright.
You can find Friends Black and his music on his website, friendsblack.com. F-R-A-N-Z black.com.
It's gonna be alright.
Welcome back to the Rod Eccles Show. I am still your lovable host, L. Rod. The phone number is still 603-835-3224 here in the Granite State. If you want to still want to try to get in and give me your two cents, maybe you want to talk about the candidates running in North Carolina or in Nevada. Lots to talk about on Hillary and Bernie, as well as what's going on in South Carolina. Got some new poll numbers out. Somebody also wanted to, a good friend of mine, going way back, he suggests that maybe I should discuss and explain the superdelegates. Now, here's why I'm not going to do that at this time. Because, frankly, and I'm never going to lie to you folks, I'm going to tell you when I don't know something, I don't fully understand how it works myself. When I thought I did understand it, and I was actually doing some reviewing of it, I realized, well, geez, this is not what I thought it was at all. It's actually worse, folks. It's worse, but I need to get some clarification on some things before I can tell you exactly what this superdelegate thing is all about. Because I don't want to sound like I'm just trying to, you know, shoot things out of my rear end here at you. I want you to understand that when I tell you something, it's because I've looked at it, I've researched it, I've educated myself on it, and I know what I'm talking about. And right now, what I thought I knew about the superdelegates on the Democratic side, some of it I didn't actually know. And it's a little bit confusing. So I need to get some clarification. Now, if you fully understand, and I don't even think that Wasserman Schultz fully understands how it works, but if you fully understand how the superdelegate superdelegates work for the Democrats during a campaign, then please call in and explain it fully. Because there are a lot of people out there, both, you know, be they Democrat, be they independent, be they Republican. They want to know the truth, but they don't understand how this all works. And I thought I was going to be the smart one and say, well, yeah, I already understand it a little bit, so it should be easy just to go in there and figure this out so I can explain it to people. And I start looking at it, I'm thinking, wait a minute, that's not what I thought. And then I go someplace else to see if I can back up that information, and it tells me something different. So there is even confusion among the Democrats right now about how the superdelegate thing works. So, and last time I saw something is Debbie Wasserman Schultz, she was asked how it works, and I don't think she gave a real coherent answer on it. So actually, I may not be able to understand this because I don't think anybody else does either, but I will give it a shot. And when I figure this out, hopefully later this week, I will try to explain it to you fully. That is something I do want to, because a lot of people are confused about this. And now I know why a lot of people are confused, because the people who implemented this stupid thing, this idiocy, are confused among themselves. That's typical. Take something that really isn't all that complicated and make it as complicated as possible so as nobody be able to understand it, least of all the people who are implementing this new strange and complicated policy. It's just beyond me why they would even... look, I understand why they did it, because they wanted to be able to usurp the authority of the people within their own party. Look, understand that. Who do you think is behind this whole effort to get rid of delegates in the first place, or the Electoral College for president? Because they point out, oh my goodness, yo, Al Gore, he won the popular vote. He got more popular votes than President Bush got. Bush stole the election. We need to get rid of the Electoral College. No, we don't. And let me explain to you, Lucy, the brilliance of our founders on the Electoral College. So hopefully people will stop saying that we need to get rid of it. You see, the brilliance of the executive office of the United States government is that, well, first of all, you need to understand, I can't believe I have to do a civics lesson on our government. I guess I'm going to have to go all the way back. Let me explain this fully so you get a perspective, because a lot of people really don't understand or know this, by the way. And this is due to lack of education, lack of civics in our classroom. You have three co-equal but separate branches of government that do completely different things, at least they're supposed to. You have the legislative branch made up of the House of Representatives or House of Commons and the Senate or House of Lords. Understand that? If you don't understand House of Commons and House of Lords and how it works in a European parliament, then do your own research, please. But this is where they took models of different styles of representative, democratic, and republican types of governments throughout history, and they brought them together to make our republic, our democratic republic. So you have the legislative branch, which is made up of the House of Representatives and the Senate. If you're looking at parliamentary types of governments, that's equal to the House of Commons or the common man, and the House of Lords or the royalty factor or sector, the king's court, if you will, in modern times. Then you have who's, and they're responsible strictly for writing the laws and overseeing certain departments of the country, overseeing, you know, making sure everything is fine. They have committees that look into all this kind of stuff and make sure everything's running fine and is legal and up to snuff and constitutional. You have the executive branch, which is headed by the president of that executive branch, in this particular case, the president of the United States. And understand, this works on your state level as well. You have a legislature in your state. You have representatives that represent various districts. You have senators that represent in most states, there are fewer senators and representatives, which represent larger districts, most likely counties, within your state. And you have the governor, which in reality is actually the president. Now, I've explained before that this country made a mistake by calling governors governors, kept the term governor instead of calling them president. Because they were, if they had not gotten the 13 colonies to agree to become a union called the United States, they would be 13 separate countries. They were 13 separate countries right after the Revolutionary War. They were 13 separate countries, but they didn't change the name of the executive leader of the state, which was then called a governor because they were governing the territory of the kings and queens of Europe who claimed ownership of all of this land. So they made the mistake of not, they weren't perfect. They made a mistake of not changing the title from governor to president, because that's exactly what your state governor is they're actually the president of your state. So they're the governor. And then if you take that back to Washington, the third, and the governor and the president is charged with upholding the laws as set forth in the Constitution of your state and the Fed level, as well as the laws that are passed and accepted by passed by the legislature and accepted, signed into law by the president or governor. He's responsible for making sure all that stuff actually works, enforcing the law. And then on the state and the federal level, you have the third branch, which is called the judiciary. This is the judges' sector. In some states, your judges are elected. In some states, your judges are appointed. And in some states, depending on the level of what the judge is, whether it be a local, a county seat, or a state seat, or a Supreme Court seat within the state, your judges might. Some of them might be elected and some of them might be appointed. It varies widely across this country when it comes state to state judges. But on the federal level, all judges are appointed. They are nominated by the president and approved by the Senate. Now, the job of the judge is not to write the laws. The job of a judge is not to tell not to say what kind of laws must be written by the legislature. No, the job of the judge or the judiciary is to interpret the laws on the books. How are they to be best implemented, and do they match up with the Constitution? Are they constitutional in the first place? So if you have an issue with a law and you think it's unconstitutional, you take it to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is not necessarily the final arbiter of what is constitutional and what is not. If the Supreme Court says that this particular law is unconstitutional, that's it. The Supreme Court is not allowed by constitutional law to rewrite any part of the law to make it of that proposed law to make it constitutional. Their job is to say, this is not constitutional and this is why. Now, if the legislature disagrees, they have two options. They have the option of going back. Well, actually, they've got three. They can either throw out the law, or they've got the option of rewriting the law so that it becomes constitutional, or going to the people and to the states and amending the Constitution, thereby making that law constitutional. We've had a massive breakdown in this at all levels of government. This is the problem. Now, in their wisdom, they fully understood that there were parts of the government, the legislature, that was based on representing the individual people of the individual district, the House of Representatives. You had the House, the People's House. They call it the People's House because they represented the people's interest at the federal level. And then you have the Senate. Now, the senators were originally appointed by either the state legislature, depending on the state's constitution, or the state's governor. And they were there to represent the state's interest. Not necessarily the people, but the state. Now you see, The state was looked at by the federal government as being a co-owner of the country, if you will, along with the people. So you had to have somebody who represented the people directly and their interest directly, House of Representatives, and you had to have somebody to balance it out by representing the good of the state or the whole state's interest, the Senate. Now, if you're representing the people, well, you represent so many groups of people at one time. Let's use raw numbers. So they plan to have a representative for every 100 people. This is not the actual number, but I'm just using it for raw numbers. So they have 100 people. And you have one particular state that has 500 people where they're going to get five representatives because there's one representative for every 100 people. And you have a state that has 1,000 people where they're going to get 10 representatives because there's 1,000 people. 100 people times 10 is 1,000. So you got state A that's got five. They go into the House in Washington, D.C. Then you got a state that's got 10 because they have a bigger population. So those 10 representatives also go to Washington. And they're all, each one of those 15 representatives are representing their 100-person lot, if you will, in their district. That's what they're supposed to be doing. So state B is much bigger population-wise. So they're going to have more people in Washington, D.C., in the House. Now, to even things out for the state, they said, well, you know what? Each state is going to have their representation of the people. That's going to be responsible for representing the people. So there could be, you know, state could have, you know, an unlimited number of representatives. But when it comes to representing the state itself, the state interest balances
it's
all
It's awesome
out.
For me to be able to put out...
Each state, no matter how big or how small, is going to be equal to
especially
senators.
Especially when you put this much time into
There's
something
two.
That you love, something you have a passion for.
So no matter what,
that's motivation.
Unless the Constitution is changed, each state is never going to have more than any other state. And each state is always going to have two. Plain and simple. Equal representation on the state. Now they make up the Congress. Never knew if they will listen, but when I write, I produce passion. And of course, you have the House, and they put their bills together and try to propose laws and actions and things like that. The Senate does the same thing, and they often try to, you know, they often butt heads and try to work things out, that kind of thing. So they can send these bills that they both approve up to the White House, which is run by the President. Now, the President is supposed to represent the entire country. Senator represents his state, his individual state. He's supposed to represent. A congressman is supposed to represent his district or his 100 people. So the only person in this entire conglomerate of a government that represents everybody, the nation as a whole, all 318 million people, is one person, the president. Thereby, if you have one person who represents everybody, doesn't everybody's vote get to count then? Well, yes and no. And see, the founders saw this and said, wait a minute. What if someday, looking at populations, and New York, because of New York City, was growing by leaps and bounds. What if someday we get one state or a couple of states that become so big that they have so many people that they begin to dictate, simply by sheer numbers of population, they begin to dictate what the rest of the country does. So in reality, if you fast forward today, we have, you know, what, five or six super states, basically. You've got heavily populated. You've got New York, California, New York, Florida, Texas, Who did I miss? Illinois. Long, Alice. The rest of the country pretty much is something that's called flyover country. So really, there's a handful of states, less than 10, that if you win those 10 states, no matter what the rest of the country does, you will win. You understand? If you get the popular vote in most of these 10 most populous states, the other 40 states really do not count. And that is exactly what the founding fathers did not want to happen. They saw this ahead of time. So they said, we are going to do something called an electoral college that is based on, in part, population. And you're going to be able to have, you're only going to have so many delegates or electoral votes. And this was an attempt to balance out the big states from the small states, to make them a little bit more equal in the choosing of executive office president. So this keeps pretty much the small states like New Hampshire and Iowa from being looked over and passed by and not being paid attention to. Because now it becomes a notion that, well, they still do it strategically. They still run around strategically trying to map out, you know, what states are going to win, what states are going to lose, what states are going to be, you know, toss-ups that they're going to go and work in. There's still football-like strategy in planning a presidential election for the candidates. But it's pretty straightforward. But when you get to the Democratic side and the Democratic nomination process and the Democratic primary, and you start talking about these superdelegates, well, from so far from what I've learned, none of that other logic falls into play with them. See, they can, now you have to understand, when it comes to electing people, that's constitutional. That is locked into the Constitution. What individual parties do to nominate people to run for public office, that isn't under the purvey of the Constitution. That's up to each individual party, if you will. If you have a party, or even if you don't have a party, you could be a non-party, kind of like a Tea Party. You know, there's nothing in the Constitution that dictates that you have to belong to a party in order to run. There's no constitutional protection for parties per se. There's nothing written in the Constitution that says that there has to be a Democratic Party and a Republican Party or a Whig Party or a Liberty Party or a Tea Party. There's nothing in the Constitution for that. So in other words, this whole notion of how we elect or nominate people for different parties has nothing to do with the Constitution. This is all super constitutional, or I should say extra constitutional, outside of it. Now, your state may have written in its constitution about what construes a party, political party or not, but there isn't anything on a national level. And indeed, not every state, I don't even know if any states do have anything in their state constitution that bring up the notion of parties. But if you do, it's definitely not in every state. But you don't have to belong to a party in order to be. Look at Bernie Sanders was not a member of a party. He was an independent. Let's take a quick call here. 706, you're live on the Rod Eccles Show. What you got?
To get everyone to vote for Trump. He's the best. He's going to make America great again.
So, let me guess. You're a Cruz supporter.
Not quite.
So, why do you think the Donald is going to be the most?
He's the most qualified. I mean, our country is in debt so bad, and that's what he does. He makes deals, and he will make everything right.
Well, what if he doesn't? You know, this is what we heard about Obama.
Well, you know what? He's better than what he's going to do. I think he's got a better shot to make everything happen.
Well, let me ask you this. Now, I know a lot of people there are very few people who disagree with this. That Ted Cruz is the most conservative on the Constitution out of any of the candidates right now, including Trump. And I doubt you find anybody who would disagree with that. Ted Cruz is the most constitutional thinking when it comes to candidates and Republicans. Forget the Democrats. They don't have anybody over there that thinks about the Constitution. On the Republican side, it is Cruz. And they've often taken people like Rubio and Trump to task in some of their, shall we say, less than fully constitutional ideas. Do you think that Trump is going to be a constitutional leader?
Okay. Let me ask you this. Okay, sounds like you are saying this is fine.
No, I never said that. No. Okay, I never said that. I'm trying to say what
you're talking over me. Can I speak? You're talking over me.
Well,
okay. Cruz is not electable. He cannot get enough people to vote for him to be the Democrat. Trump can. Trump is bringing people in that would not even vote for a Republican. So you tell me,
I'm not arguing with his electability. I don't know how many times I have said before that right now it looks like Trump is the most electable by dragging.
Do you not want a Republican to win?
I would like.
Because
I would
Cruz,
like.
You, if Cruz is the if he's nominated, he will not win.
I've heard some people say that. Well, what about Rubio then? Rubio is highly.
Rubio awesome. Will not win.
Well, he's highly elected. No, well,
the only one that is going to win is Trump. So everybody needs to get it together.
I understand what your position is, but if you look at the polls, the one who beats Hillary by the widest margin on a national poll level is Marco Rubio. Now, by me saying that, does that mean I'm supporting Rubio? I'm just telling you what's out there.
Okay, how many people come to rallies for Rubio?
He
doesn't get them. He doesn't get the people.
Okay.
I mean, it doesn't take a genius to figure this out. We've got to do what's going to be electable. And it's not Rubio. And it's not Cruz. And it sure ain't Bush.
Well, I would have to agree with you on the Bush part, but yeah, I get you.
Yeah, but I understand where you're coming from, but, you know, we've got to look at it. Who can bring the most people in to vote?
Okay, I got it. I definitely get it. Well, folks, there you go. We'll be right back.
Give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Sign him up for the Box of Bait Club and he'll never be hungry again. The Box of Bait Club is a brand new dream come true for every fisherman. Something new and different in your tackle box every month. Every month, another excuse to get outside and do what you love. Don't let this one get away. The Box of Bait Club is currently accepting a limited number of pre-orders with subscriptions starting at $39.95 per month. Find out more now. Log on to boxofbaitclub.com.
I'm just so happy my father had a chance to see his kids before he passed. I just want to say thank you.
When her father fell ill, the American Red Cross was able to help get Veronica's brother home from the Navy to speak to his father one last time. It's thanks to your donations that we can connect military families when they need it most. Please donate today at redcross.org.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-616-8010. That's 1-800-616-8010. Again, 1-800-616-8010. Call now.
Attention business owners. We know that owning a business means getting things done right now. So if your right now list includes a new building, call the Right Now Company. General Steel. We can design a building for your business quickly and save you thousands of dollars. That's right, thousands. You may think General Steel only builds large projects or that you can't afford General Steel quality. Well, check these prices. How about a 40 by 60 foot building for under $22,000? Or even a 50 by 100 for under $35,000? That's right, a 5,000 square foot building for under $35,000. And these buildings all have General Steel quality. Best of all, you can still order a building and have it delivered in time to build this year. How's that for right now? So if your right now list includes a new building, call the right now company, General Steel.
800-393-5756. 800-393-5756. 800-393-5756. That's 800-393-5756.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
Boy, man, I had a rough night's sleep. Boy, whew. I got a letter from the IRS yesterday, and I just couldn't sleep. Man, I'm dying here. Somebody help me.
IRS problems affect more than just your finances. If you're ready to take back control of your life and you owe more than $10,000, you need to call the Tax Doctor. Their expert staff can immediately protect you from the IRS and state collectors and get you the best possible tax settlement guaranteed. The IRS has recently released new programs geared in helping struggling taxpayers, where you may qualify to settle your tax debt and wipe out up to 85% or more of what you currently owe. If you owe $10,000 or more in back taxes, call the Tax Doctor right now. See if you qualify to pay less. 800-989-1694. 800-989-1694. 800-989-1694. Again, 800-989-1694.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. We leave no warrior behind. Wounded Warrior Project is a nonprofit organization created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war. Whether those scars are physical or mental, we're here to make sure that they heal. And whether it's helping those with post-traumatic stress disorder live a normal life again, or giving much-needed support to injured warriors and veterans hospitals. Because no one deserves our help more than the men and women who risk their lives to keep us safe. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind. Ever. Learn more about what we do at WoundedWarriorProject.org.
You want to know what time it is? It's time to bring the rain.
Zinc Media. Feel the power of knowledge.
I've always been in awe in this race, especially since the beginning, since the the bulk of the people got into the race, especially when it comes to Trump and Cruz. It's amazing that if I defend, rightfully so, if I defend Cruz on anything, I'm all of a sudden, I'm one of those nasty Cruz supporters. But vice versa, if I defend Donald Trump on anything, you know, Donald's right about something. If I say that, Donald's right about this or this, and it's, oh, whoa, you're just a Trumpster. You're a Trump person. Man, you don't know anything. If I ask you a question about something, it is simply because I'm trying to seek balance here. Because as I have said, there is no perfect candidate. And when it came right down to it, when I had to choose a candidate for my primary, I had to go down and choose somebody that I only agreed with only 70% of the time. So that means that there's a lot of room for growth for any of these candidates to step up to the plate and get me on the rest of that 30%. And it's just unbelievable how we've gotten to this point where we've just made these candidates like potentates or something. We put them all up on a pedestal. He's the only candidate, and he's the only candidate. Trump is not the only candidate that can win the general election. Rubio's not the only candidate who can win the general election. This notion that Cruz cannot win the general election is a false notion. It is absolutely false. It's wrong. And look, I get people's frustration. I get your frustration. I do. Let me just, if you're going to call the program, the call-in number is 603-835-3224. I have set the rules down before. We do not take blocked numbers here. Now, that is for security reasons. I have learned since doing this program in 2009 that you never take a blocked number. There is no reason for you to call this program or any program with a block. There are very few programs, both on the air and on the internet, that will take calls from blocked numbers. And it's for show security reasons, not for national security reasons. So if you're going to call, remember to unblock your number. We need to be able to see it, especially when there's only one or two people that are running the board. We need to be able to see the number. We need to know that there's a real person on the other side and not somebody who's trying to subvert the system. But this whole notion, folks, that you know, I'm pulling for, I guess according to the last caller, I must be pulling, since I said something nice about Rubio, I must be pulling for Rubio, too. I don't know how I can pull for both the Cruz, and I can't pull the lever for more than, well, maybe if I was a Democrat, I could pull the lever for more than one candidate. But as a Republican who believes in the Constitution and who follows the law, I can only pull the lever once, so... And only for one person. Anyway, welcome back, folks. It is I, your lovable host, Elrod, coming to you live from my bunkerized home studio somewhere within the great granite state of New Hampshire, where the state motto is still live free or die. It is not big government or bust. And I like that we are a live free or die state. I really do. And look, if you like New Hampshire, I love the fact that you love New Hampshire. But if you are a liberal... or a moderate who loves New Hampshire, please just visit for a vacation, then go home. Leave me my state to myself. I implore you. The people of this state really are, look, we would love it if it went back to the people who really love the state of New Hampshire, who do not want this state to be like any other state, who don't want it to be Massachusetts, who don't want it to be Connecticut and Rhode Island. We want it to be left alone. Look. You got Northern New England is so different from Southern New England. It's ridiculous. You would not believe that it's in the same region. You run down the Rhode Island and Connecticut and the eastern half of Massachusetts, and you think you're in a different region of the country. Because then you head north, and you get into Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont, like totally different. I mean, it's like that. Massachusetts is like has that border that goes across that cuts off northern New England from southern New England. And it's just like night and day. When you cross that northern Mass border, it is like night and day. Even if you go out to western Mass, western Massachusetts, out past Springfield, west of Springfield, is beautiful. Absolutely gorgeous part of the state. And they tend to be a little bit more conservative. By the way, did you know that that's where Bill Cosby lived. Bill Cosby lived in far western Massachusetts. Western Massachusetts, that's where sexual deviant lives now. Massachusetts is the home of a major sexual deviant. Okay, yeah, maybe. But it's a gorgeous part of the state, and it is also, for Massachusetts, probably the most conservative part of the state. Now, it's not conservative, but it is the most conservative part of the state. And they have a different way of living out there versus you go east into Worcester and into Greater Boston. It's totally different. Same thing as you, although it is changing quite rapidly here in southern New Hampshire. But if you go up and as soon as you hit the New Hampshire border, you notice there's a remarkable difference versus down in Massachusetts. Now, with cities like Nashua and Salem, they're getting a huge influx of Massachusetts people. So that's rapidly changing, and the border is kind of blurring that at that point. But as soon as you get out of those major areas, you even the big city of Manchester is quite different from what you get down in the Massachusetts area. And you go north of Manchester, over to the seacoast, over to the Vermont border. It's a totally different state compared to what Massachusetts is. And then, of course, you get up into Maine and Vermont. Well, it's more than night and day. Even though Maine has been, traditionally speaking, for the past few decades, very liberal, along with Vermont. Vermont is one of those, now, see, this is the whole point that I'm trying to make about how different northern New England is. Southern New England, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Vermont, you've got gun control like you would not believe. Northern New England, Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine, gun control is much more lax. And as a matter of fact, you have in Vermont has got to be one of the most odd states there are. They've got a socialist senator that they readily reelect. They've even elected numerous Democrats that were on the, basically socialist governors. They implemented social medicine in Vermont. They like to say that Vermont is very progressive, but you don't even need to have a gun permit in Vermont. If you are a law-abiding citizen and do not have a felony, as long as you're legally capable of having a gun, you can have a gun in Vermont. In fact, you can be driving down some of the back roads, country roads in Vermont, and you'll still see guys that have a shotgun hanging in from the back window of their pickup truck. I kid you not, I've seen it. Now, that does not jive with a socialist type of notion of the government always taking care of you. So how does Vermont balance that? Well, I tell you how they do that. Vermont has had this heavy influence from where? From the tri-state area of New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. They all go up to Vermont and they buy these big, these large pieces of land and they build these big, beautiful vacation homes. And then they decide that someday, they want to actually live there. So they're bringing this tri-state liberalism up into Vermont. Now, much like New Hampshireites who are natives, they're being outnumbered, and they don't particularly like it. They could go along with electing a Bernie Sanders, but there are certain parts that they're not going to take, and they stand and fight and make sure that whoever, it's kind of like New Hampshire with the taxes. There's no state income tax. There's no state personal income tax. There's no state sales tax. And even if you are a Democrat in this state, you had better take the pledge about not wanting to institute a statewide personal income tax or a statewide sales tax. Every candidate, I don't care if you're a Republican or if you're a Democrat, if you cannot take that pledge, you most likely do not win. You will lose. So even though New Hampshire is being liberal a lot, liberalized by people from, and I see, if you go to these major apartment complexes in southern New Hampshire, especially in Nashua and in Salem, New Hampshire, and to some extent places like Derry and Manchester, if you go into the parking lots of big employers or you go to big apartment complexes, you will see license plates from Massachusetts, from New York, from California. I kid you not. There's a lot of Californians. Now, they originally lived here. You know, maybe the kids went west, and they failed out there for whatever reason, and they're now back home in their home state. But anyway, there are a lot of California plates. We're getting a lot of influx, and this is changing in the southern part of the state. They're beginning to outnumber their traditional Republican, traditional conservatives. But even then, if you do not take that pledge, you have no chance of winning a state office. Because people are serious about not wanting the government. And this is with many so-called liberals or moderates as well. They will not vote for somebody who is going to implement a broad-based personal income tax or a broad-based sales tax. It's happened since the 90s. And if you're running for governor, oh man, look, we've had governors that have been incumbents, you know, been elected three or four times, and then they decided to obey because they get bigger than they think they are, and they abandon their pledge of no broad-based income or broad-based sales tax. And they, no matter how many times they were reelected before, they get booted. As soon as they drop that pledge, they get booted. Because the people of New Hampshire just will not go that liberal. At least not yet. Again, something totally different from the southern half of New England. And of course, you get into Maine, and now Maine's got this Governor LePage. I mean, you want to talk, he's a little strange, but you know, we are talking Maine here. But again, you're talking to people that are just so different from southern New England. Now, Mainers really do go at a slower pace. And that whole notion of the, you can't get there if I'm here, that's reality. That is not just TV. Look, I go to Maine a lot. That is Maine reality. That's not a TV persona. Not everybody in Maine has that down east accent, but that is their persona, that is their mentality. And you've got this Governor LePage who is implementing some really, really strong right-wing agenda ideas that are working in that state. And let me tell you, the people of that state are loving him. Again, totally different from that Massachusetts border on south. The whole dichotomy is just the difference is still night and day. I know the lines are kind of starting to blur a little bit in southern New Hampshire, but I think that is going to be reversed because there are some major problems in our border cities in New Hampshire, in Nashua, in Salem, in Derry, that the people of the state are just getting really fed up with. And I think there at some point there's going to be some major changes coming to those communities, and that line differentiator that we call a border is going to start to firm up again, and you're going to start to see some major changes because Nashua used to be a beautiful small city of about 75,000-80,000 people. It's now about the size of 88,000, and it has been devastated by drugs and gang members and stuff coming up from Massachusetts. And the people of Nashua, many of them who've escaped areas in Massachusetts to come to New Hampshire for safety and education of their kids, they're finding that it's being usurped by these people, and they've had enough. They've had enough. So I think what we're going to see is a return. And look, anywhere, a lot of places that you go across this country, when things begin to happen and people have had enough, it's because they're having enough of the stupid liberal ideas that allow that kind of stuff to happen in the first place. And people start begin to turn towards conservatism. Look, you got a lot of people down in the on their southern borders, you know, Texas, Arizona, Southern California. They've had enough of this illegal immigration stuff. They've had enough of it. And you're starting to see them look to and turn towards people who are more conservative when it comes to those types of things. They want somebody like Trump who's yelling, I'm going to build a wall. That wall is going to be big. That wall is going to be beautiful. It's going to be fabulous. And you're going to see it's going to be a good thing. They want somebody like Trump. And if they get wind of anybody, say like a Rubio, that sounded like at any time in their recent past that they were for amnesty and they were for keeping open borders, they are going to get trounced in those areas of the state. They don't want that. Look, they've had enough. If you sound like maybe, you know, Cruz, I was for it before I was against it, they're going to question the hell out of you. Look, that even brings up Trump. Trump has usurped his position before. Because before, now you can go back and listen to him on tape. There was before, a few years ago, during the Bush administration, Trump was for a more liberal immigration policy. He's on record. So, folks, when I take you to task, when you call up about something and you say that you support this person because of this particular issue, look, they've got a history. And you better be prepared to be able to back your candidate up. That includes you Trumpsters. I'm sorry, but it does. And it does not mean that I'm a Cruz supporter, I'm a Rubio supporter, I'm a Bush supporter, because I take you to task on Trump. I also take all of them to task. I don't let anybody get by. Nobody skates on this program. Nobody. So this is, maybe this is why this program has seen the growth in listenership that it has seen over the past few months. Because I do not believe in handling any candidate with kid gloves. None. And I don't do fluff piece interviews. I know somebody's going to say, well, you just did that with Ginta, Rod. You just did a fluff. No, I didn't. There was a reason I had Congressman Ginta on here. I wanted him to talk about the budget process. Now, in the meantime, since we arranged to have him on the program, we've had Justice Scalia pass away. So that had to be asked about what was going on with Congress, what he thought. Because he's in Congress. He can give me some insights on what's going on. I'm not here to take him to task about anything. I'm trying to find out the insights and let you hear the insights of what's going on inside the halls of Congress right now. Now, granted, if Congressman Ginta wants to come on as a candidate, yeah, there are some questions I have about him on some of his policy that I will definitely ask him about. But that's later on. Nobody gets a fluff piece here. This is truly fair and balanced. You know, Fox says there's fair and balanced. No. I'm fair and balanced because I want the truth. And that to me, that's the only fair part, is getting to the bottom and getting to the truth. That is the only fairness that I care about. If you call, and you know, I admit I try to be equal with everybody, but I'm nicer to some callers than I am to other callers. I'm human. I try my best to be equal and level throughout the field. But, you know, one thing you cannot do is call here and tell me that, oh, you're just a Cruz supporter. No, don't even go there. Because that's really not going to bode well for you. So I know who I support. And I am pretty sure, listening to some of my interviews, because I've begun to listen to myself. I don't like listening to myself. But, you know, in order to try to improve the program, you got to listen to yourself every once in a while to try to critique it. I'm pretty fair. pretty fair. So, you know, if you want to call 603-835-3224, it's all well and good, but understand that, you know, I'm just, I don't know how to let people understand and know that I'm an independent person. Sure, I have sponsors of this program, but those sponsors do not own me. They do not buy me. And I'm not going to back off on certain things. It just, I can't. It's not my personality. I just want this country. Look, this is still a great country. It really is. It really is still a great country. But it's not the best on the planet anymore. Now, I'm going to be frank with you. How can you be the best when you have all sorts of organizations, you know, U.S.-based organizations, world-based organizations, that grade countries on all kinds of things, and the USA does not come in first or second in any of those major categories? You know, when it comes to freedom, we're not number one or number two when it comes to personal individual liberty anymore. How is that possible? We're not number one or two when it comes to our educational system anymore. We're not number two when it comes to our post-educational system anymore. We're not number one or two when it comes to our economy and the growth of the economy anymore. How are we the greatest nation on the planet when we're not number one or two in anything? Great nation still, yes. The greatest, no. And I believe that the reason why we are not the greatest is because we've fallen into this just-get-by type of European attitude that socialism is okay for everybody, and it's the only way to go because it sounds fair. Even though it's not fair, it just sounds fair. But understand, there isn't anybody in Europe that's all that happy about socialism. So why the F would we want to follow in their footsteps is beyond me. When we were the greatest in number one and number two in all those major worldwide measured categories, we were a constitutional country with conservative values and conservative ideas. That's what's going to make this country the greatest on the planet once again. Conservatism, not liberalism. Liberalism takes you down a road of despair. Conservative takes you down a road of prosperity and freedom. Don't doubt me.
Your credit score is a joke, and you're too embarrassed to let anyone know your three-digit score. Sucks to be you, but it doesn't have to. Delete all those unsightly derogatory items, collections, charge-offs, repossessions, judgments, tax liens, bankruptcies, and foreclosures. To turbo boost your credit scores, call 888-541-5571 or visit us at 700creditnow.com. You've heard the old adage, cash is king. But in some cases, credit can be just as powerful as cash. Not many people have $200,000 to put down on a house, or $50,000 to put down on a car, or $25,000 to put down in a business. But look around and you'll find that millions of Americans do have homes and cars all purchased with little to no money down. To turbo boost your credit scores, call 888-541-5571. Again, that's 888-541-5571 or visit us at www.700creditnow.com.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break. And at the worst possible time, call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-616-8010. That's 1-800-616-8010. Again, 1-800-616-8010. Call now.
Did you ever look at the stains in your coffee cup and then realize that's exactly what happens to your teeth? Power Swabs is the 5-minute solution to get your teeth white without visiting the dentist. This is Ben Gordon with Power Swabs, and if your teeth are stained from coffee, tea, or smoking, all it takes is 5 minutes with Power Swabs. In 5 minutes, you'll see an average of 2 shades whiter teeth, and in 7 days, 6 shades. It's clinically proven to whiten natural teeth as well as caps and veneers. The secret is a tooth detergent that was developed by Dr. Martin Ginniger that lifts stains off of your teeth. Best of all, there's no messy strips or trays that you have to leave in your mouth for an hour. Just swab your teeth for 5 minutes and you're done. To try Power Swabs risk-free, call 1-800-291-5140. That's 1-800-291-5140. I guarantee your bright white smile will have your friends talking about how great you look. Try it risk-free today. 1-800-291-5140. That's 1-800-291-5140.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
When you're ready to take the edge off a hectic day, I suggest you start with a little music from Franz Black.
I guess there's lots of ways to look at things that don't seem right.
No Worries has just been released on iTunes and Amazon.
It's gonna be all right.
You can find Franz Black and his music on his website, franzblack.com. F-R-A-N-Z, black.com.
It's gonna be all right.
And we are back. Welcome back to the Rod Eccles Show. 603-835-3224 is number to call. The state.com. After the debate over the weekend, Trump still tops the South Carolina GOP presidential race. There is a poll out now that puts Trump at 35 and Cruz and Rubio at 18% each. However, on the Democratic side, and this came out, this is a poll that came out yesterday. On the Democratic side, Clinton leads Sanders by a 21-point margin. Now, Sanders is making gains among critical African-American voters, but still trails by 40 points. Now, I don't think Sanders is really making inroads in the African-American community, so to speak. You know, when it comes to that side, it's not a complicated mess, but I mean, it's really simplistic, yes. But it's complicated. Now, I will give Trumpsters this. The whole Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders thing, as far as African Americans are concerned, the African American vote, it is complicated by Trump. Which this is not something that's happened in a very long time. Not since Reagan. That the African American community is starting to split. Because there are a number of African Americans who are currently or were diehard Democrats who are jumping on the Trump train. Now, you know, those two wonderful ladies that I love dearly, I hope someday I get to meet them in person, Diamond and Silk. I wouldn't have a beer with those two. I'd have a bottle of wine or two with those two ladies. I think they're fantastic. The politics aside, you know, it doesn't matter who that they're rooting for. What I love is that their honesty, their energy, and their ability to look beyond the Democratic plantation. Looking for a better way for themselves, their family, and their communities. And they have left that Democratic slave mentality plantation behind. That is what I really admire about these two. Now, it's not easy being an African American and supporting somebody so openly on the Republican ticket. It is not easy at all. And yet these two ladies not only support a person on the Republican ticket, they support Donald Trump, but they're bringing and dragging willingly a number of other African Americans along with them. Now, they have made inroads in the African American community far better than I have. And I give credit where credit is due. They have done a fantastic job, and I would give them credit for starting to fracture the hard Democratic mentality of many African Americans. And they're causing them to go over to Trump. Now, that's a problem for Clinton and for Sanders. Why the hell do you think Sanders is seen meeting with none other than the Reverend Al Sharpton? He's pandering for his support so he can try to get the black vote, because the black vote is being siphoned away from the Democratic Party to the Republican side, specifically to Donald Trump. Now, all you Cruz people and all you Rubio people and all you Bush people, you got to understand this. It does not mean that I'm rooting for Trump. I'm telling you the truth. The truth is that Donald Trump is doing something that the other candidates on the Republican ticket are having a very difficult time of doing right now, and that is garnering liberals, garnering so-called moderate and conservative Democrats, and garnering the African American. The rest of the camp in the Republican Party ticket is not doing that yet. It doesn't mean that you can't or that they can't. I'm just telling you that right now, Trump has already got it. And he's building on it. And you better start taking a look at what Donald Trump is doing to attract these people without being racial. Donald Trump is not pandering to these people talking about, well, you know, he's not saying one thing to one ethnic group and another thing to another ethnic group. Donald Trump has got one flat message across the board that everybody's jumping on board to. So if you're another candidate on the Republican ticket, I would definitely take a look at seeing what Donald Trump is doing, seeing what Donald Trump supporters are saying is important to them, and you better start emulating that. I'm just telling you. That's the truth. Now, you Cruz and Rubio people can hate me all you want to, but I'm telling you the truth right now. This is why Donald Trump is in the lead by such large numbers. And if you go into states where independents can vote in the primary, you are in big trouble if you're not a Trump supporter. If you're supporting one of the other candidates, you've got a huge problem on your hand, because he is attracting independents in droves. That's the problem for the rest of the candidates. Now, I might align myself more politically speaking with some of the other candidates, but let me tell you something. I understand what Trump is doing and where his support's coming from. And you ignore that, you Cruz and Rubio people, at your own peril. I'm just telling you. By the same token, however, Donald Trump's inability to garner the real conservative vote, risk that if he doesn't talk to them, I don't mean change his message, but if he doesn't talk to them at their level and really convince them and alleviate them of some of their conservative concerns about some of his potential policies, he's going to run the risk of what Romney ran into and lose that conservative base, and they're going to stay at home come Election Day, thus giving a boost to whoever the Democrat is. Now, I know it's dumb for them to stay at home and not vote. I get it. I know. I've even heard some people say, I would rather vote for Sanders than Trump. I don't know how you come to that conclusion, because you're talking about two opposite ends of the political spectrum here. You got a guy who's never really been in the private sector, hates the private sector, hates big business, hates rich people, and you got a guy who is the epitome of rich people, who's the epitome of capitalism. But you're going to go from him. Oh, I don't like him. I'm a conservative, but I don't like Trump. I'm going to go for Sanders. I mean, I don't know how you justify that. That's total insanity in my book. I just do not know how you justify that. There is no way to justify that. And, I mean, I've heard and we've seen some of these people say, well, they would rather support Sanders. There is no justification. If you are a Cruz supporter, especially, and I've heard Cruz supporters say this, I do not fully, there's no possible way on God's green earth that you can tell me logically why it would be better if Cruz is not the nominee and Trump is a nominee, that it would be better to vote for Sanders than for Trump. If you're a Cruz supporter, I've heard Cruz supporters say this, oh, I'd rather vote for Sanders than Trump. Why the hell would you even believe that? Why? That makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. Donald Trump and Ted Cruz are the exact opposite of Bernie Sanders. But you're going to tell me that because your guy, Cruz, is not the nominee, if he's not, you're going to vote for Sanders? How does it make... What, you're going to try to punish the rest of the country? Do you remember that you live here too? And that your children live here and your grandchildren are going to live here? Your posterity is going to be here? Are you forgetting that fact? And that whatever, are you forgetting the fact that if you get Sanders into the White House, that he's going to have the potential to nominate and put 5 Supreme Court justices on the court? There's only 9 justices, folks. More than half the court could be nominated by one president. And you're going to tell me that Sanders would be better in that position than Donald Trump? I don't understand the mentality of some people. I just don't get it. Look, understand, anybody left on the Republican ticket right now, any of them, including Jeb Bush, is 1,000 times better than a President Hillary or a President Sanders. Do you understand that? There is no justification for you to run off to the corner in the corner of a room, suck your thumb, and pout because your candidate didn't get nominated. No justification whatsoever. Put on your big boy britches and your big girl skirts, buck up, grow up, and then get out there and support the Republican candidate, because there is not a single Republican candidate left in the race right now that would be worse than Hillary or Sanders as president. Not a single one. Not even Jeb. Not a single one. If you want to be a single issue candidate, you're a fool. You are a total and complete fool if you're going to vote based on one issue. That's why I always say it's got to be 80%, 70 to 80%. Find the candidate that you agree with on all the issues, major issues, 80% of the time. And if you actually did that, some of you might find out that your candidate, your current candidate of choice, should not be your candidate of choice. You know, two and a half weeks ago, I actually did this with somebody. We were just having a nice, quiet, and I never brought this up, but we were having a nice, quiet conversation. And she is going to hear this and know that I'm talking directly about her, but I'm not going to say any names. But we had a conversation about this, about the 80% rule. And I started just talking to her. You know, we're business friends, if you will. You know, we don't hang out personally, you know, in personal time, recreational time. But business, I see a lot of her during business times, doing business. And we're very friendly, and we've gone out to business functions together. We've done all. No, I'm not dating her. If anybody's going to ask, but no, just she's a business friend, a very close business friend. And you know, we were talking about a week, two and a half weeks ago, and talking about, you know, the primaries and all that kind of stuff, and who she was having a hard time support. She had a candidate of choice that she was leaning towards, and I just said, well, look, what are the top 10 issues that you find most important? And she listed her top 10. And we actually did this. I just started writing them down. So, okay, these are your top 10. Now, what do you know about all the candidates as they relate to this? You know, we started going down to each candidate. And lo and behold, the candidate that she agreed with most was not the candidate that she was leaning towards supporting. So I looked at her and I said, well, I think your choice has been made, and it's not who you originally thought, is it? She says, Rod, you know what? No, it's not. And I got to tell you, all of you people who are so adamant about being a Rubio supporter or a Cruz supporter or even a Trump supporter, if you did this same thing, if you just wrote down your top 10 issues that you would like to see the president address when they become president, write them down, and then go down line by line how each of the candidates, as you know it, stands on each one of those issues, and check off to see which candidate you agree with on their current positions on those major issues of yours. You might find that you're supporting the wrong candidate. That's going to blow your mind. That will completely and totally and utterly blow your mind. I guarantee it. Because when you start looking at things in writing like that about your top 10 issues, you take out what? Personality. See, a lot of people are attracted to somebody because of personality. You may like Ted Cruz's personality. You may love it. You may love Donald Trump's personality. You may love Rubio's personality. You may even love, you know, Kasich's or Bush's personality. But when it comes down to the issues, personality means jack when it's relating to how they're going to handle the issue that you find important to you. And you're going to find that personality, when looking at those top 10 personal issues, is irrelevant. Because if you want small, ultra small, conservative constitutional government at any cost, then I'm going to tell you, the most conservative, most constitutional candidate in the race, like it or not, folks, is Ted Cruz. If you want this country to be run like a business, because that's how you believe it is going to be great again, if you want somebody who's adept at building things, both businesses and actual structures, then like it or not, Donald Trump is your guy. If you want somebody who is very erudite and adept and knowledgeable about domestic and foreign issues, and who's got the experience and the leadership team that he could put into place to handle all of that stuff, whether or not it is to your satisfaction, but they're the most qualified to handle all that stuff, it is, unfortunately, Jeb Bush. Do you get it? And some people might say, Jeb, look, Jeb Bush has got the team. Jeb Bush will have the people at his beck and call. You're talking about the younger brother of two popular former presidents who were heavily involved in foreign affairs. There is nobody who is more stacked on the foreign affairs issue than Jeb Bush. Not a single all the other candidates combined cannot bring to the table what Jeb Bush can bring to the table day one as far as foreign affairs is concerned. I'm just telling you the truth. Does that mean I'm a Jeb Bush supporter now? Whether or not you agree with his foreign policy or you agreed with his dad's foreign policy or his brother's foreign policy is irrelevant. The guy who's got the deck stacked the most on day one is Jeb Bush. Now, look, when you start taking the candidates, when you get rid of personality and you start taking the candidates apart issue by issue, it presents a whole different picture, folks. And I guarantee you that some of you out there listening to me today, if you take my advice, you are going to change who you support. You will. And that may scare some of you to death. But it's okay. Now, some of you, you may double down, find out that the candidate you're currently supporting is the perfect person. And you're going to double down on him. I know it. That's not a bad thing either. Because then at least you know that you'll be supporting them based on the issues that matter to you. And it has to be more than one issue. That's why I said top 10. There's got to be at least 10. If you're a single issue person, you're an idiot. There's got to be more than one issue in your life that you're concerned about. And although I'm a pro-lifer, if your main issue is abortion and Planned Parenthood, you're an idiot. Because what good is it to preserve life if everything else in that life is going to destroy them after they're born? Just saying. Abortion cannot be the main issue. And you cannot vote for a president based on whether or not they're pro-life or pro-choice. Sorry, you can't. That's idiocy. Single-issue candidate supporters are very dangerous to the whole Democratic process. Because what happens if they get in there in day one, you know, first month, first 90 days, whatever, they solve your issue to your satisfaction? Well, then they've got the rest of the 4 years in office to do all kinds of other things that you may not agree with. Oh, but they got that one issue done, so you know you can live your life on that one issue. Yeah, I can see that. Mm-hmm. I can definitely see how one issue is the end all be all to everything. The rest of the world, you get rid of abortion on demand in this country, then everything else on the planet is right as rain. There'll be no more war. There'll be, it'll fix everything. Crime will go away. Wars, because everybody's focused on the reason why we have so much strife on this planet is because the United States allows abortion on demand. That's it. Yeah, I get it. And once we stop it, once we stop abortion on demand, the entire rest of the world will fall into line and realize that we are that shining light on the hill, and they will all raise us up in the United States and think that we're so great, and they will do whatever we ask, whatever we want, and the rest of the world, all the dictators will lay down their weapons and their whips and their chains, and everything will be right as rain. And even North Korea will then want to become a part of the rest of the world and lay down their nuclear ambitions and all their war rhetoric and everything else. They'll get rid of UN. They'll get rid of it, everything will be right. No, that won't happen. That's a fantasy. That's an episode of Sliders. Yeah. So why are you a one issue a candidate supporter? If there is one issue that is going to change, if that person as president gets that issue solved to your satisfaction, if that one issue is going to change the entire planet, then okay, I say go for that one issue on that one candidate, because that'll fix everything. But if that one issue is not going to fix everything, then why are you a one-issue voter? You see how ludicrous that is? Do you see how silly that is? That's why I always say, take your top 10 issues. Trust me, you're probably going to sit down and ask yourself, well, what am I concerned most about this country and this world? You're going to end up with more than 10, I can tell you that. If you're a person who absolutely pays attention and understands what's going on all around them, you're going to end up with more than 10 main issues. You may end up with 20. But I'm just telling you, take the top 10 and rate each candidate on whether or not they agree with you or don't agree with you on how you want each one of those problems solved. And you will probably find out that the candidate that you are currently endorsing, you're endorsing strictly on personality and not based on the issues and whether or not you agree with them. Now, I would like to see if somebody, well, maybe somebody should try to do a poll on this. I don't know. Try to figure this out. Look, there are all kinds of places that you can go to online. You know, do a Google or a Bing search, and you can find these, you know, and they tell you exactly where the candidates stand on some of the issues. And you can line them up then. But most people, one of the things I find interesting is most voters do not go to any of those places. They do not look at any of those things because they're stuck on personality. I guarantee you that if we actually knew what Barack Hussein Obama stood for, that the majority of people who voted for him, they voted for him on personality. If they actually voted for, if they actually looked at his issues and where he stood on them, they wouldn't have had a leg to stand on to vote for him. I'm telling you. They wouldn't. Which is why all these candidates have also got to be more careful and stop trying to sound. Look, I am so happy that the mainstream candidates today, the top three, top four, are not trying to sound like Democrat lights. They really aren't. Sure, maybe on one particular issue here or there, they might sound a little bit like a Democrat light. But the general basis of their campaign and what they stand for, they don't sound like they're trying to out-liberal a liberal. Where on the left, you've got Clinton trying to out-socialist Sanders. And Clinton hasn't learned this fact from the Republicans. Look, if people want a socialist, they're not going to go for a socialist light when they can have the real deal socialist. You can't out-socialist a socialist. You can't out-liberal a liberal. And it's about time that we start saying and understanding that you can't out-conservative a conservative.
Give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Sign him up for the Box of Bait Club and he'll never be hungry again. The Box of Bait Club is a brand new dream come true for every fisherman. Something new and different in your tackle box every month. Every month, another excuse to get outside and do what you love. Don't let this one get away. The Box of Bait Club is currently accepting a limited number of pre-orders with subscriptions starting at $39.95 per month. Find out more now. Log on to boxofbaitclub.com.
I'm just so happy my father had a chance to see his kids before he passed. I just want to say thank you.
When her father fell ill, the American Red Cross was able to help get Veronica's brother home from the Navy to speak to his father one last time. It's thanks to your donations that we can connect military families when they need it most. Please donate today at redcross.org.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-616-8010. That's 1-800-616-8010. Again, 1-800-616-8010. Call now.
Attention business owners. We know that owning a business means getting things done right now. So if your right now list includes a new building, call the Right Now Company. General Steel. We can design a building for your business quickly and save you thousands of dollars. That's right, thousands. You may think General Steel only builds large projects or that you can't afford General Steel quality. Well, check these prices. How about a 40 by 60 foot building for under $22,000? Or even a 50 by 100 for under $35,000? That's right, a 5,000 square foot building for under $35,000. And these buildings all have General Steel quality. Best of all, you can still order a building and have it delivered in time to build this year. How's that for right now? So if your right now list includes a new building, call the Right Now Company, General Steel.
800-393-5756, 800-393-5756, 800-393-5756. That's 800-393-5756.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
Boy, man, I had a rough night's sleep. Boy, whew. I got a letter from the IRS yesterday, and I just couldn't sleep. Man, I'm dying here. Somebody help me.
IRS problems affect more than just your finances. If you're ready to take back control of your life and you owe more than $10,000, you need to call the Tax Doctor. Their expert staff can immediately protect you from the IRS and state collectors and get you the best possible tax settlement guaranteed. The IRS has recently released new programs geared in helping struggling taxpayers, where you may qualify to settle your tax debt and wipe out up to 85% or more of what you currently owe. If you owe $10,000 or more in back taxes, call the Tax Doctor right now. See if you qualify to pay less. 800-989-1694. 800-989-1694. 800-989-1694. Again, 800-989-1694.
On the battlefield, there's a saying America's military men and women live by. Never leave a fallen warrior behind, ever. Off the battlefield, Wounded Warrior Project operates with the same goal. We leave no warrior behind. Wounded Warrior Project is a nonprofit organization created to help our men and women returning home with the scars of war. Whether those scars are physical or mental, we're here to make sure that they heal. And whether it's helping those with post-traumatic stress disorder live a normal life again, or giving much-needed support to injured warriors and veterans hospitals. Because no one deserves our help more than the men and women who risk their lives to keep us safe. Wounded Warrior Project. We never leave a fallen warrior behind. Ever. Learn more about what we do at WoundedWarriorProject.org.
Zinc Media. Feel the power of knowledge.
are back for hour number three here on the fastest 3 hours on Internet Talk Radio, which is the Rod Eccles Show. And I am, of course, your lovable host, L. Rod, coming to you live from my bunkerized home studio somewhere within the great granite state of New Hampshire, where the state motto is still live free or die. It is not big government or bust. As we continue and roll on this Tuesday, February the 16th in the year of our Lord, 2016, morning, top of the hour to you. Top of the morning to you. Look, folks, if you understand this, if you did not get the sense on Saturday's debate that this is about to get down into, no, this has been tame. The process has been extremely tame, comparatively speaking, up until this point. As we continue to look at the polls and how they stack up on the left and how they stack up on the right, it has become increasingly clear to every single person who's still in the race right now that unless the Republican candidate just totally botches it, the next person who is the Republican nominee will be the president of the United States come November 2016. They will be it. So this right now, what you're seeing on that, and I didn't watch the debate, but let me tell you the highlights. It made me think maybe I'm sorry I missed it. But let me tell you, there is a battle, a severe battle. Look, you've got the Republicans, the blue bloods, the inside the beltway, the establishment. They're fighting for their very lives. Because they see you, the American people, who are trending towards people who they do not consider to be insiders. And the support that they have given people like Carson and Rubio and Cruz and Trump scares the establishment to death. And even when they seem to pick a potential popular establishment candidate like Bush, can't get any traction. Then they said, well, maybe Christie could be our man. Couldn't get any traction. Rubio got a little bit of traction, but then you had the other two inside the Beltway candidates, take him down a notch or two. Rubio, again, Rubio is on that edge. There are some things that he's with the establishment on and some things that he's not with the establishment on. And the establishment thinks that they can eventually get him under their wing and control him. But I think that the establishment is going to be surprised by the strength of Rubio. Because Rubio, he was a Tea Party darling when he was first ushered into the Senate. And the establishment thought, the first thing we got to do is corrupt this guy. That's what they thought. And with the Gang of Eight, they thought they had succeeded on the immigration issue. But then Rubio decides, well, you know what? I'm going to run for president. And the GOP thinking, the establishment thinking, well, that's okay. He's in our camp. And then he starts opening his mouth, and the GOP's like, oh, hell. We got a problem. We don't really control this guy. I'm just telling you what's going on. Look, I'm getting this feedback, and I hear this stuff from people who know a lot of this stuff inside the Beltway stuff. And let me tell you something. Rubio, they truly think that they can control Rubio, but he is a loose cannon to the Republican establishment. Rubio is a loose cannon. They do not have full control over Rubio. They want you to think that they do, but they do not. And I know that the Trumpsters and the Cruzites want you to think that Rubio is an inside the Beltway type of guy, but he is not. Because the inside the Beltway GOPers do not believe that they have control over him. They thought they did, and they found out that they don't. That's the gossip that's going on inside the halls of power in Washington, D.C. You've got these guys. It is going, this presidential race for on the Democratic, on both sides, is going to get much nastier. And I know people are going to say, well, the GOP, they can't do this. They'll rip themselves apart. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you who's going to rip themselves apart if they're not careful. Not so much the GOP, because we've always done this. It's the Democrats. And let me tell you, they started this 8 years ago with Clinton and Obama. And the schisms were created back then. They were not bridged. Even though you thought they would have been, because Obama decided to have Clinton as his Secretary of State. You thought maybe that schism and those trenches that were dug would have been, you know, filled in and leveled. No, they were not. They were not. Clinton is angry as hell that she didn't get the nod back in 08. She's pissed. You would not believe that this woman has held on to that anger for 8 years. And let me tell you something. The reason why Obama made her Secretary of State was to shut her up, because I can guarantee you that if she was not in the Obama administration, she would have been out there. She would have been a thorn in his side. Obama's not stupid. He knew full well that was going to be the case. The schisms have not been healed and filled in on the Democrat side. And now you've got the Democratic establishment who is fighting for their very lives to keep Bernie Sanders out. Now, here's a guy who left the Democratic Party in big voice, big style fashion. He just didn't quietly say, "I'm now an independent, I'm leaving." No, he made sure that everybody knew. It was a big deal that Bernie Sanders was going independent and he was leaving the Democratic Party because he didn't like what they stood for anymore. He thought they were too mainstream and not socialistic enough. And Bernie Sanders was this far left type of guy. And he thought that maybe if he got on the outside of the party, he'd be freer to do what he wanted to do. And that's exactly what he did. The Democrats, the DNC, has not forgotten that. They do not want Bernie Sanders, who is essentially, even though he's running on a Democratic ticket, an outsider, much like Trump is to the Republican Party. They don't want him. The DNC does not want him. They have designed the superdelegate stuff in such a way that even if Sanders wins, he most likely loses. In other words, it is going to be a way that the Democrats can have a brokered convention to nominate Hillary Clinton should Bernie Sanders get the popular vote. Look, we're hearing, you know, Rubio's tossing this about. Maybe we should have a brokered convention. Because he wants to be the nominee. He believes that he's going to be the nominee in a brokered convention. This is why Rubio is saying this. Let me put it to you this way. Rubio needs to wake up. If there is a brokered convention, if it comes down to a brokered convention, and if Jeb Bush stays in the race, he's going to be the brokered nominee. Guarantee you, not Rubio. Rubio thinks that he would have the best chance of being coming out on top in a brokered convention. No, it's going to be Bush. Why? Simply because his name is Bush. Understand that? The Bush family still wields tremendous power and influence with inside the Beltway GOP. Tremendous. They are still highly popular. Don't doubt me on that, folks. Do not doubt me. On the other side of the political aisle, you've got Clinton and Sanders. They've only got two candidates. Now, if Clinton goes down in flames because of her legal problems, trust me, if they want a brokered convention, Biden is going to be their second choice. Now, you need to watch over these next few months very closely what Joe Biden does, what President Obama does. Watch closely who President Obama nominates. If he puts forth a nominee for the Supreme Court, that will signal to you what which way the Democratic Party is going to go. Because they are fighting for their very existence as well. And if Obama nominates somebody who is ultra-liberal, that is going to be a jab at Clinton. Understand it. It is going to be a direct, open... Now Obama knows it. If he nominates an ultra-liberal to the court, they are most likely not going to be approved by the Senate. And the Senate will filibuster this whole issue until after the election. They're probably going to do that anyway. But definitely if it's an ultra-liberal. But if he nominates an ultra-liberal, it is a direct gunshot at Hillary Clinton. And you have to understand that the DNC, even though they have tried to back Obama all they possibly could, Obama is not their guy. He's only their guy because of his skin color. You want to talk about racism, that's it. The inside the DNC, they're seething that Obama has left them in such a weak position. They understand this. They understand that Obama's weakness has given rise to Bernie Sanders. They're not happy with Obama. But they have backed themselves into a corner by promising Hillary Clinton this thing. That's what kept Hillary quiet for the last 4 years since she, 3 years since she left the State Department. Look, this was a whole brokered thing from the beginning, folks. I'm not into conspiracy theories, but understand from what I'm hearing, the whispers inside the halls of power in Washington, D.C., the DNC told Hillary, look, you're going to get the nominee in 4 years if you just let Barack be for a while. We got to get through this so we can put you in place. And she basically said, look, don't screw me over this time or it's all over. They have to back Hillary Clinton to the hilt. Why do you think they forced Joe Biden not to run? Because they didn't think Bernie was going to get any traction. But they fully knew well that if Joe Biden got into the race, it would be a threat to Hillary Clinton and it would be a threat to her nomination. Why do you think Obama was standing there when Joe Biden made, what was that, like a 20-minute speech to tell everybody that he wasn't running? You don't take that. You don't write a speech that way to tell people you're not running. Unless you're telling people, I really did want to run, but they're not letting me. But if anything goes wrong, I'm here for you. That's what that speech said. And Barack was standing right next to him to make sure that putting his foot in the mouth, Joe Biden didn't put his foot in the mouth. He didn't gaff. That's why he was there, to make sure that Joe went through with it and didn't gaff. So they have doubled down on this Clinton thing like you would not believe, because they can't have Sanders. So listening to them, this is why I got more confused trying to figure out how this superdelegate crap works. Is listening to Wasserman Schultz, I just became more confused than ever about how the superdelegates work for the Democrats. That's why I got to look into it more. I thought I got a handle on it, and then she says that she opens her mouth, and I think, well, maybe I don't have a handle on it, because hell, she doesn't even have a handle on it. And this is this is going to get real nasty, folks. When it comes down, as we approach Super Tuesday, you think that the fireworks that you saw last week on the GOP stage and the fireworks that you saw at the last Democratic debate, oh, that ain't nothing yet. That was just a preamble, if you will. This is going to get nasty, and it is going to get very, very bloody. And let me tell you something, as I told folks before, Trump is very capable of dishing out blow after blow after blow. He took on, during that debate, every single candidate on that stage. And I got to tell you, he didn't even unload both barrels. Just telling you. Some people think, well, Donald is, you know, his ego is too big. That's exactly what makes him the most dangerous person on that stage. Is Donald Trump has got an enormous ego. Good or bad, I don't care how you view it, good or bad, but that makes him the most dangerous person on that stage, politically speaking. He does not care what those other men on that stage think of him. He does not care. There is not a single one of them on that stage right now that has done anything in the private sector that equal to Donald Trump. Not a single one. Not even Dr. Carson. Yeah, Dr. Carson has had some private, private sector success, but nothing that is equivalent to Donald Trump. What's more, all of those candidates know that, as well as Donald Trump. Now, I know some people are going to say, "Well, geez, that means he's on the Trump train." No, it doesn't. I'm telling you the truth. This is going to get much bloodier. You know, politics is a blood sport, folks. It is, and Trump is such his own man that he does not give a rip what those others think. And he is going to lob grenades, toss under them landmines, shoot off cannons from ships. He is going to fire broadside into each and every one of them. And let me tell you something. Rubio showed that at the last debate that he was not prepared to be broadsided. That's a problem for Rubio. And if you Cruzites think that Cruz is immune, that he's got full plate armor, uh-uh. He does not. Cruz has got, you think that the Donald has got some big weak spots? Let me tell you something. Cruz has got some weak spots, and Donald is going to exploit them. Big time. And the problem I have with Cruz is that Cruz is such a rehearsed, polished politician. And he's so polished on so many different things. But Donald is going to find those aspects where he is not practiced and polished, and it is going to hammer him on those issues, and it is going to hurt Cruz tremendously. Just look what happened to Rubio. Rubio was prepared for certain aspects of a Bush attack. But then Christie attacked him on certain aspects that he wasn't so polished and prepared on, and he fell apart. Cruz also has those chinks in his armor. The benefit of Donald is that Donald knows he's got chinks in his armor, and he doesn't care. The rest of them care so much that they're going to try to hide it. That is also a weak spot. As soon as they take on the attitude, now this is where Cruz took off. Cruz started to emulate on certain aspects that matter to the most people. He started to emulate Trump, and Cruz started to get noticed. He started to be politically incorrect. He was the first non-Trump person to be politically incorrect on the campaign trail, and he took off. Just telling you. The strategy in this is such that no matter what they have lobbed at Trump, because Trump doesn't, his ego is so big, he doesn't care. And he keeps on going. Even when he knows that he stumbles or gasps, doesn't faze him. And if you notice, no matter what the left, no matter what the lamestream media, no matter what the other candidates have done or said or lobbed against Trump, it's all bounced off of him. Even when you think that he knows he made a gaffe, he doesn't even... You know what he does when Donald Trump makes a gaffe? You know what he does? Instead of trying to back up and reposition himself and go around it and try to, you know, cement it over and make it all nice and smooth, he doubles down on it. Nobody's ever seen this before. This is not in the political playbook at all. When you make a mistake, you apologize for it in one form or another. You try to walk it back. And you try to correct it and fix it and try to explain, well, this is what you... Nah, Donald Trump does the exact... He doubles down on it. Oh, it was politically incorrect to say that you know, Mexicans are sending their worst scum into the country, you know, criminals and drug pushers and drug dealers and rapists and all this kind of stuff. And they tried to take in the task on it. And Donald Trump said, no, I didn't say all. I said some. They're still not sending us the best they have to offer, but they're still sending us these criminals. He doubled down on it. And everybody was like losing their minds, except the American public, who looked at Donald Trump and said, yeah, that's right. That's what we've always felt and been saying. And then not only did he double down on it once, he doubled down on it when they tried to take him to task on it again. And finally, I think most of the candidates got it. And they stopped trying to take him down on that particular issue. Because each time they did, he doubled down on what he said before instead of walking it back. And he gained popularity. Look, Cruz was the first one to recognize this. I got to tell you. He was the first one to recognize this. He was the first one to start to adopt some Trump-style campaigning. And he took off. And that propelled him to a win in Iowa, I guarantee you. So don't... No, I know, I'm giving advice to all the campaign people out here. You want to win? Have your candidate be his own man. But have him be more like Trump. Like Trump or not, I'm telling you, whether you're a Trump supporter or not, folks, there are reasons why the Donald is in the lead by a handed, you know, a big margin in some polls. There is a reason Donald Trump crushed it in the state of New Hampshire. I'm telling you. And, you know, they better understand this really quick. Because when it comes down to it, you know, I mean, look, this is going to get bloody. It's going to get, these candidates are going to get battered. But don't worry, Republicans, because the Democrats are going to get just as bloodied and just as battered. I mean, Bernie Sanders smells blood in the water. He now really, truly believes, and he is convinced that he can get the Democratic nomination. He's got the public support. He never expected to have this kind of support. But he's got it. And that's got the DNC running scared, just like the GOP is running scared of Rubio, Cruz, and Trump on the other side. This is going to get real interesting real fast, folks. Hang on. Put on your seatbelts.
Your credit score is a joke, and you're too embarrassed to let anyone know your three-digit score. Sucks to be you, but it doesn't have to. Delete all those unsightly derogatory items, collections, charge-offs, repossessions, judgments, tax liens, bankruptcies, and foreclosures. To turbo boost your credit scores, call 888-541-5571 or visit us at 700creditnow.com. You've heard the old adage, cash is king. But in some cases, credit can be just as powerful as cash. Not many people have $200,000 to put down on a house, or $50,000 to put down on a car, or $25,000 to put down in a business. But look around and you'll find that millions of Americans do have homes and cars all purchased with little to no money down. To turbo boost your credit scores, call 888-541-5571. Again, that's 888-541-5571 or visit us at www.700creditnow.com.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break. And at the worst possible time, call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-616-8010. That's 1-800-616-8010. Again, 1-800-616-8010. Call now.
Did you ever look at the stains in your coffee cup and then realize that's exactly what happens to your teeth? Power Swabs is the 5-minute solution to get your teeth white without visiting the dentist. This is Ben Gordon with Power Swabs, and if your teeth are stained from coffee, tea, or smoking, all it takes is 5 minutes with Power Swabs. In 5 minutes, you'll see an average of 2 shades whiter teeth, and in 7 days, 6 shades. It's clinically proven to whiten natural teeth as well as caps and veneers. The secret is a tooth detergent that was developed by Dr. Martin Ginniger that lifts stains off of your teeth. Best of all, there's no messy strips or trays that you have to leave in your mouth for an hour. Just swab your teeth for 5 minutes and you're done. To try Power Swabs risk-free, call 1-800-291-5140. That's 1-800-291-5140. I guarantee your bright white smile will have your friends talking about how great you look. Try it risk-free today. 1-800-291-5140. That's 1-800-291-5140.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 dollars a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 800-595-2614 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 595-2614 to take your call now. Call 800-595-2614. That's 800-595-2614. Again, 800-595-2614.
When you're ready to take the edge off a hectic day, I suggest you start with a little music from Franz Black.
I guess there's lots of ways to look at things that don't seem right.
No Worries has just been released on iTunes and Amazon.
It's gonna be all right.
You can find Franz Black and his music on his website, franzblack.com. F-R-A-N-Z, black.com.
It's gonna be all right.
Three five three two two four is the number to call should you wish to join me here on the Rod Eccles Show. I am, of course, your lovable host, L. Rod, the Rod of Truth, and so many other nicknames. Some of them good, some of them not so good nicknames. But if you guys keep making them up, I'll keep using them. I guess maybe I'll take some of them as a badge of honor. Some of the terrible names, because if that means I'm actually getting to people, I'm getting people to think. That's the whole point behind this whole program, is to getting people to think logically, not with their heart, not with their, oh, wouldn't it be so nice type of, no. We want people to think logically here. Definitely do. That is the whole reason. You know, you got the Washington Post out there that is talking about the debate. They're still talking about the debate. I mean, they're beside themselves. They can't believe what happened at the debate. Over the weekend, the GOP debate, and you know they're rubbing their hands. Oh yeah, the Republicans are going to tear themselves apart. But see, the problem is that they're ignoring the same types of things that are going on over on the Democratic side, and how the Democrats are. And there's only two of them. Do you realize that the GOP, on the GOP side, what, there's still six, seven candidates left in the race? And there's only so much damage, because there's so many of them, that they can do to each other right now. It's not a one-on-one thing. On the Democratic side, you've got two people. That's it. So if they take each other down, there's nobody left. Well, I guess you could say, well, it'd be Biden. Look, that would be the death knell for the Democrats, is if they went a brokered convention and put in Biden. I don't think they're going to have much of a choice. They don't. They can't put in Clinton in a brokered convention and get away with it. If she doesn't win the popular vote and popular delegates, and they try to use these super delegates to broker Clinton in, that's going to really tear the Democratic Party apart. They would have to find a third person, which would more likely than not be Joe Biden. Now, I'm sorry, Joe Biden, no matter what the lamestream media pollsters say, Joe Biden just cannot win. You know, the Democratic bench this time around is not very deep. And the DNC saw to that. You know, they basically did not allow people like Chafee and the others on the Democrat side to even get any traction. They didn't allow them to. I think it was Lincoln Chafee that complained that the lamestream media wasn't giving the other candidates press and media coverage. And they did that on purpose to make sure that they didn't get any. I think that they didn't even get above 2% support after Sanders and Clinton shook things up. I don't think the other Democratic candidates actually got more than 2% of the vote or support. And I just think it became, by the way, there's been another death in the public eye. Those of you remember Prince, you know, and then he became known as a symbol, the artist formerly known as Prince, and then he became Prince again. Well, Prince did a couple of girl bands back in the 80s. One of them was Vanity Six, and there was another one. I don't know why he used the number six, because in Vanity Six there was only three girls. Then there was also another group that he put together. Again, it was only three of them, but it was something six. I forget what it was, but Vanity Six was the most successful. Then what it gave rise to. There's, you know, they had a few pop hits back in the 80s. Remember that? But in any case, the lead singer of Vanity Six was Vanity, and she did a few movies back in the 80s. You know, she was actually a terrible actress. You know, she was a terrible actress, by the way. But she did, you know, she appeared in some TV series back then. She did a few movies. And Vanity was very, she's considered a very beautiful girl back then. And she was. If those of you remember Vanity, her real name is Denise Matthews. And she passed away yesterday at the age of 57. And they're saying this is stemming from her drug use back in the 80s and 90s. In fact, she back in the early 90s, I guess she did almost die. She OD'd on coke. And I guess it left her kidneys extremely... Remember that? I remember the stories behind that. She left her kidneys extremely damaged back then. And but she passed away yesterday. Now, for some of you might not remember her songs because of the group Vanity Six. She's the lead singer, as I said. Well, that's why they call it Vanity Six, because, you know, she was Vanity. But she was in movies like The Last Dragon and Action Jackson and a few others. She had a lot going for her. And then she had, I wouldn't say brains, because she never came across as being, you know, brainy in any of her movies. She came across as being sort of kind of like the 80s version of not an airhead, but ditzy. And that's kind of how she acted, too. And maybe she was, and maybe she wasn't. I don't know. But she had a lot. She had everything going for her. She had Prince in her corner, you know, bucking up her girl band, Vanity Six. You know, Nasty Girl was, I think, their biggest hit. And she was doing movies towards the mid and late 80s. And appeared a few times on some TV series. I think she appeared on the Cosby Show once. Don't quote me on that. I'm not sure. I just think I remember seeing her on the Cosby Show. But in any case, she had it going on. And then, like so many of them, they let drugs get into their picture, inside their lives, and the drugs take over. And she OD'd on coke, nearly died back in the early 90s. And it looks like at the age of 57, that abuse back then caught up with her. Denise Vanity Matthews, dead at the age of 57. Just to bring you up to date. So we've had a number of high profile celebrity, if you will, deaths this year. We're just in the week seven of this year. And how many people have we've lost? I counted them back in December, and we were like losing one a day. We are over, you know, we're over the one a day number. I think we're somewhere approaching 60 well-known people, if you want to use the term celebrity, go ahead. But well-known people that have passed away since January 1 of this year. This is one of those things that has got me wondering and worried. Are people checking out because something awful is about to befall the living? And they don't want to be around to suffer what the living are going to be suffering over the next few months or possibly years. I don't know, but just to be checking out now, all these people checking out now, it's got me kind of worried. I'm not a superstitious kind of guy, but it just seems a little odd. And some of them I know, and there are people when you're talking to about Justice Scalia, there are people that are saying that this is the death of his death is very, very suspicious and strange. And you've got a bunch of, you know, even police people and detectives and such, you know, that and other law enforcement people that are scratching their heads on the lack of an autopsy of Justice Scalia. Didn't we have the same thing? There are people out there that are making the comparison with Scalia that they and Breitbart's death. Again, all of a sudden, Breitbart just, you know, healthy, happy, having a good time, and one day he says he's not feeling well, and boom, he's gone. Scalia, yeah. You know, No health problem indications ahead of this whatsoever. Just one day, you know, he goes down there. He says, well, I'm kind of tired, need to get some rest. And then he's gone. And you just got to wonder, especially when they say, well, they're not going to do an odd. I don't understand. Well, it's natural causes. Well, how do you know it's natural causes? What natural cause killed him? Heart attack? Stroke? No, we don't know. And then, of course, we get this stuff that gets leaked out. Well, he was found with the pillow on top of his head. Now, I know a lot of people that sleep under their pillow. I mean, I've been known to wake up with a pillow on top of my head. I don't think anybody was came into my room and tried to smother me in my sleep. But you gotta wonder. No autopsy. He's found pillow on top of his head. But one of the things they're not saying is whether the pillow was on top of his head and he was face up or face down. Now, usually when I wake up and the pillow's on top of my head, I'm face down. It's a little bit more difficult to suffocate somebody with a pillow if their head and their face and their mouth is face down. But if they're face up, you can suffocate somebody. So was he facing up? Was he lying on his back? They haven't said. They just said, well, you know, we found a pillow on top of his head. Doesn't tell us much. Just raises suspicion about a bunch of stuff when it comes to that. Just saying. I don't easily buy into conspiracy theories, but it is, and people are pointing to Barack Obama's acknowledgement of Justice Scalia's death. You know, I've looked at it, and yeah, the president seems to be fighting back a smile and a smirk, you know, every once in a while as he's discussing Scalia, and that really doesn't mean that Obama had anything to do with the death of Scalia, other than the fact that Obama is just a jackass, and he on the inside he is jumping for joy that Scalia is dead. Because that guy was, the Supreme Court Justice Scalia was a thorn in Obama's side more than once. And trust me when I tell you Obama is happy that he's gone. And the sour note or sour tune that he tried to play during that presser, giving his, he didn't mean any of it. He didn't. Well, I had so much respect. You know, he didn't have respect for Scalia. He loathed him. Couldn't stand the man. Because Scalia stood in his way. Now, I know one of the things that really is kind of weird is I've had this notion for a novel, a suspense novel. And it was about, the basis of it was about political assassination. But not assassinating political leaders in the United States. Because often, you know, the assassinations, we take out the president. This was about taking out three of the justices on the Supreme Court. To in order a change in the balance on the Supreme Court. So, and how that all worked out, and you know, did any of the just, I'm not going to say, did any of the justices actually get killed? Who were the, you know, what were their political leanings? Did they get targeted? Blah, blah, blah. You know, let's just say that one of them was the Chief Justice, and the other two were closely aligned with the Chief Justice. Now, I've never put this, you know, pen to paper on this one, but the idea has always swirled in my head. And I'm thinking maybe I should take some time to actually write this one out now and use some of the details surrounding Scalia's passing in it. That would be kind of interesting. But there have been other novels that have, and there have been TV shows every once in a while that have taken this sort of plot on, but nobody ever believed that was possible for reality. Well, my, how times have changed. And now there are plausible, highly plausible, whether they actually come to be proven true, we don't know. But plausible conspiracy theories abound out there as it pertains to the death of Justice Scalia. And look, I don't. You know, so the Democrats are going to try to sweep this under the rug as quickly as possible. And they're not going to talk about it. And the lamestream media, for whatever reason, they're not going to talk about it. And the information is going to come out in drips and drabs, and people are not going to have the information they need to make a fully informed personal decision on what they believe or not believe about this whole situation. And you're just going to have wild speculation and conspiracy theories, which is going to give more cover to those who, if there is any dirty deeds that have been done, those wild conspiracy theories are going to give them more cover. Just saying. So we don't know enough, but it does raise questions when you have such a prominent figure who passes away on such mysterious and strange and questionable circumstances that they don't want an autopsy. I just don't understand it, folks. Being religious, was Scalia Catholic, right? He was Catholic. Hey, be that as it may, you would think that you would want to know exactly what happened to your father, grandfather, uncle, what have you. But evidently, his family's, and I don't know if people got to his family and said, button this up, for your own safety, don't ask any questions, just button it. Or they really just don't want to know. I don't get it. I do not get it. Here's some good news, though. If you are good news for people like Bill Clinton. I knew. See, I'm always here. My mind is here. I don't have anything called dementia. Now, you could say people like Ronald Reagan and a few other political people from the past, they may have had Alzheimer's and dementia and stuff, but I'm not going to get that kind of thing. You wonder why? It's because of this story right here. I'll tell you, my mind is going to be healthy till the day I die. You could probably say the same thing about Elliot Spitzer, and this is from express.co.uk. Having sex, especially if you're an older man, is a way to ward off dementia, scientists claim. This is the story. Basically, getting frisky between the sheets can benefit your male brain health, according to Coventry University. Older men who enjoyed regular lovemaking showed signs of a healthier brain. In particular, they were able to recall, list, and recognize patterns easier, faster, and better than men who did not have regular carnal knowledge. I almost said it. Encounters. Men who didn't have carnal knowledge had a higher rate of things that are related to dementia versus men who had regular carnal knowledge experiences. So the researchers quizzed some 6,800 people aged 50 to 89 from across England, and they were asked about their sex lives and a set number of mental tests. Now, participants were played a list of 10 words and asked to recount them after 5 minutes. They were also given a number sequence with one number out of place and asked to correct the pattern. The men who were sexually active scored 23% higher on the word test and 3% higher on the number puzzles. But it wasn't just men who benefit from a sexy lifestyle. Sexually active women also scored higher on these cognitive tests. Researchers believe that sex hormones like dopamine and oxytocin, which are linked to the part of the brain responsible for reward, could help cognitive function. You know that part of the brain after you're so euphoric and lightheaded after having sex? Well, that's because of dopamine and oxytocin gets your brain, your whole body, actually, those chemicals. Your body produces those chemicals, and sex produces and floods your bodies with those feel-good chemicals. So, if you are, especially if you're a man, one of the things that's going to keep your brain healthy, I guess, is if you have lots of sex. Now, evidently, they did not quantify the sex. They didn't say it was, you know, one kind of sex was better than the other. In other words, just having a sexual encounter versus lovemaking. So it didn't seem to differentiate that, simply because in any case, whether, you know, you have just a, I don't, hey, if you're like Elliot Spitzer, you might want to, you know, didn't he get caught paying for it? Or what was he? It was a sex scandal that brought him down, right? By the way, he's in the news. Elliot Spitzer is in the news again. That's why I bring up his name. He's being accused of choking a woman. Now, evidently, this wasn't one of those, what are the sexual chokes? This was a real choke, I guess, like an assault choke. It's Spitzer. Who knows what it was? It might have been something could have been a sexual encounter or a pre-sexual encounter or something like that. I don't know, but evidently it was something that went awry, and now he's being investigated for nearly choking a woman. But I will tell you this: evidently, it is very clear that people like Bill Clinton, they're not going to get Alzheimer's or dementia. They're always going to be mentally with, whether you agree with them or not, they're always going to be mentally with it. And I knew this way back when I was like in my 30s. I knew that I wasn't going to be able to get enough from that woman. Mrs. Clinton. So I had to look for things outside of the marriage, and, you know, going all the way back to governor of Arkansas days. That's why I had those state troopers run out there and find me all these wonderful, beautiful women. And that's when I found out that I like black women too. You know what I'm saying? Because they are sexual, they are sensual, and they just like having a good time in bed, and so do I. I gotta tell you, that's the way it works. That's the way it works. You know, you gotta have fun when you're in bed. You gotta have a lot of fun because it's gonna keep your mind active. I'm telling you right now, that's the way to go. I'm never gonna get Alzheimer's. Well, you know, look, folks, just pay attention for the rest of the day and see what's being said about Scalia and the rest of the field, because all this stuff is important. But in any case, I'm out of time for today. I'll be back tomorrow for Hump Day. Until then, I'm Rod Eccles. This has been the Rod Eccles Show. I'm out.